This day of worship and celebration of God's love and our love for one another and the community we serve in the name of our Lord. Thank you for being with us here in this sacred setting. And for those of you who are joining us virtually this morning, we're grateful that you share in our worship community as well. Before we begin our worship, let's lift up together any joys and concerns as we also make notice of any announcements. You have a bulletin in the monthly newsletter that's been prepared that has several announcements printed, but there may be some that you want to share verbally today as well. I'll hit a couple of highlights. We do have Communion Sunday. We'll be celebrating November 21st. That's a busy day and a big day. We're going to have election for our elders of our church session too. The nominees from our nominating committee approved by our church session are for the elder class of 2024, Leon Bailey and Bobby Elliott, followed by Shay Scott for the elder class of 2022, the unexpired term of Steve Willie, as he and Kelly moved away. And we'll be prayerful for that day, November 21st. Also on that day, we're going to have a community Thanksgiving celebration with our friends at First Baptist Church and First United Methodist Church. Yours truly will be preaching at First Baptist, and Jason Franklin will be our worship leader that day, and Greg Beatty at First Baptist will be leading our music, I'm sure, with along with some of his choir friends at least, and we look forward to that great evening of celebration. The offering for that evening will go to assist the ministry and mission of the Tippah County Good Samaritan Center. That is also our mission emphasis for this month. So we'll gather funds throughout the month for our mission emphasis and write one check from Ripley Presbyterian Church for that evening's worship. For those of you unfamiliar with our mission emphasis, each month here at Ripley Presbyterian, we focus on a specific ministry outreach to our community and the world beyond us. Last month, it was the Presbyterian Hunger Grant. Our goal was $500. These are funds that we give above and beyond our offering. We exceeded that once again. We reached $700 for mission giving to provide hands and feet and the love of Christ to the world beyond us. So thank you for giving so tirelessly and gracious of yourself. So the emphasis once again this month will be the Tippah County Good Samaritan Center. We look forward to continuing our partnership in ministry with our friends who are most in need in our community. Are there other announcements you'd like to mention verbally today before we lift up our prayer concerns and joys? Oh, yes. Lynn will be out of the office this week. She'll be visiting with some family. So if you have any business that I can help with or one of the other elders, please reach out to one of us. And we pray traveling mercies on your visits with your friends and loved ones throughout this week. Okay. Any other announcements? Let's share together in our joys and concerns then. We continue to be prayerful for the family of our beloved Craig Goolsby and all of us who loved him and his family. We're praying for you all, Robert and Sharon, these days ahead, your grief and loss. We continue to remember the family of Brad Moran and certainly Jean Watson, Mike Watson's mother as well. We want to add to our prayer list that we received this word after the bulletins had been printed, that we want to pray for the family of Sean Bryan. That's Wayne and Hope Bryan's son. So we're prayerful for them as well. A little bit of an update on Tate Daniel. I think Tate is making some progress a little bit, isn't he, Shirley? I'd heard from Brother the other day and said he's doing a little better. So we continue to lift up Tate and your precious family. Randall Beavers, he's on our prayer list. He had an allergic reaction today, and he had to go to the hospital this morning, so haven't gotten an update of late, but told Randall we'd be praying for him and sharing our love for he and his family throughout his recovery as well. Are there other prayer concerns or joys we'd like to share this morning? Okay, hearing none. Friends, once again, this is the day our Lord has made. Let us worship God now in joy and in gladness. The psalmist calls us to worship with these words, "Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Unless the Lord guards the city, the guard keep watch in vain." Friends, would you join me in responding to that call to worship by lifting up together our prayers of confession and receiving the gracious forgiveness of our God? Would you pray with me? We confess that we have sacrificed your goodness for material goods. We have meditated on our problems instead of meditating on your promises. We have shunned your faithful love by seeking solace in sinful places. We humbly seek your mercy, O Lord. Please forgive our rebellion and ignorance, our wayward hearts and loose tongues. Restore us, O Lord, to the joy of your salvation, and make us willing to obey you. Amen. Friends, hear these words of life. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? God, who did not withhold the beloved Son, but gave him up for all of us, will God not also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen. Amen. Let's join together in our hymn of praise, number 276.
This morning's first reading comes from the book of Hebrews. It's in your pew Bible on page 224. If you'd like to follow along, chapter 9, beginning in the 24th verse. For Christ did not enter a sanctuary made by human hands, a mere copy of the true one, but he entered into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself again and again, as the high priest enters the holy place year after year with blood that is not his own. For then he would have had to suffer again and again since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the age to remove sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for mortals to die once, and after that the judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Jennifer. Would you pray with me? Oh God, we bow in your presence, grateful beyond what we can express for your grace. Your grace that welcomes us into your home as your children. Your grace that claims us in spite of our shortcomings to restore us through your forgiveness and guide us with the gift of your Holy Spirit. Even as we come, O God, in worship, we also come seeking to be molded and made more in your image. And certainly one way we do that is in the hearing and receiving of your word. So we ask now, O God, that you give us the ears to hear, the hearts to receive, and the eyes to see your vision for our lives and the world we should serve through your love and for your glory. Come, O Holy Spirit, illuminate us and our path of ministry. In the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's share together in our second reading of Scripture from the Gospel of Mark in chapter 12. We'll begin with verse 38 and continue through verse 42. Listen with me for the word of the Lord. As Jesus taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have the best seats in the synagogues, in places of worship, at banquets. They devour widows' houses, and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting in sums of money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he said to his disciples, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty has put in everything she had to live on." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Some of you may have experienced or participated in what some people would call a trust fall. In those trust fall, you are encouraged to stand if you are the direct participant, and close your eyes and trust those who are around you and just fall back. And just as you're about to hit the ground, they grab you with maybe six sets of arms. Or maybe for me it might take eight sets of arms, Kathy. But a quantity that is worth saving you from hitting the ground will capture you at the last moment. I don't know if some of you witnessed on the internet or social media once I saw a trust fall in which they didn't explain exactly correctly to the participant how it was supposed to work, because as he was standing there and they said, "Close your eyes and just begin to fall and we'll catch you." So they were all behind him, ready for him to go, and he leaned forward and fell flat on his face. When we trust, sometimes we can fall on our face, right? That is, if we trust in the wrong direction or the wrong things to sustain us. In our scripture today, we hear this text that perhaps is familiar to some of us about this journey where Jesus is ministering on his way to Jerusalem. One of his last public acts of ministry on this earth. And he begins to rationalize and inspire and provoke the disciples to their trust even more fervently in him and his ministry and his love. You know, we hear this passage where he speaks to them about beware of the scribes. And I don't know about y'all, but when I hear gospel readings like this, I try to place myself, what is this saying to me? How is this challenging me on my journey of faith? And to be honest, I've got to say, I'm happy I'm not a scribe. But as I look around me, the culture and the world around us, we don't use that language, scribe, so much in our current culture. And I was challenged by the words of Tim Keller to look a little deeper and wonder what it is or who it is in all of us that God is challenging us this morning. I want to read a little passage from Keller where he shared in a devotion recently on September 30th. And he said this. He said, "Dear social media friends," wow, I talked about the trust fall. Now Keller's hitting us in another way on social media. He says, "God sometimes mocks, and for some things, we deserve it. Yes, it's those habitually constant mocks, those who sit in the seat of mockers, as the psalmist would say, that are in great spiritual danger," Keller would challenge us. He says, "Mockers nurture high pride in themselves. They appear to be knowing and sophisticated, but truly ruin relationships with those around them. They cut off from the truth that only the humble can discover." They're cut off from that truth. He quoted C.S. Lewis. Listen to this. Lewis once said, "To see through everything is to see nothing at all." Keller went on finally, one more paragraph here. "Preachers and teachers who mock with a great deal of mockery toward their opponents, instead of speaking the truth in love, often nurture abusive spirits that bring down their ministries in the grace." He says many in social media, their main goal, their main stance, is to mock and deride people who have positions that differ from their own or oppose them. By this, the spiritual dangerousness for them is that it accomplishes nothing for their side either. God mocks the proud, but shows favor to the humble, the oppressed. See, what I hear Keller saying there, and challenge even more deeply from the gospel writer Mark today, is for us, as people of Christ, to embody a spirit of humility as we seek to serve the world through Christ's love and for God's glory. Yes, there is the challenge in our text today about giving. How do we give ourselves to the church, to the ministry of the world around us? Are we sacrificially serving those around us for God's glory? But you know, as I wrestle with this text today, I think the essence of true righteousness is not so much about how much we give to God, but how much we allow God to give to us. Have you ever thought about it from that perspective? Jesus challenges his listeners in our text today. When we give out of our abundance, or if it's not hurting in our giving, are we truly embracing our full devotion to God? He used the example, the analogy of the widow this day who gave all she had. You see, she gave all she had because she knew all she had was from God. If we truly embrace our devotion, not so much in what we can do for God, but in what God can do for us, friends, that is when transformation can occur in our life, our family, our ministry, the world around us. I feel the call of Jesus in this text today, as he's speaking to his disciples and to us modern day disciples. Will you truly be devoted and put your trust in me? Isn't that what it means to have faith? as Paul the Apostle encouraged us as he wrote to the church in Rome and he spoke of Abraham's righteousness. He said, Abraham believed God. Abraham trusted God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. You see, friends, when we put our trust in God, our devotion in Christ, it changes the way we respond, right? I saw recently, in fact, last Sunday, one of the NFL football games, many of the people were decorated in their Halloween costumes this year for football. And I saw one team who's had a particularly horrific season. They haven't won a game all year. And one of the persons in the crowd had a paper bag over their head. You couldn't see their face. You remember the Saints used to do those every once in a while, right? This person had a paper bag over their head, and written across the top was, "This is not a costume." In other words, they were for real in their embarrassment. But why were they still at the game? Because they were hopelessly devoted to their team. Such is the pain of being an Ole Miss Rebel or a Mississippi State Bulldog. At times, we are hopelessly devoted to our team through the good, the bad, and yes, even in the spirit of the Saints fans from of old, even in the ugly. We're devoted, and we give of ourselves, and we sacrifice to the point that sometimes it hurts, right? See, that's just a small glimpse, friends, of I think what Jesus is calling us to today as he embodies the ministry of the widow who truly put all of her trust in God. Her devotion to the point of depth and despair because she knew all she had was from God. I think our Lord, in this text today, to strengthen our faith in the present, reminds us to look in the past and in the future. Now let me say it this way. I heard recently that there was a fraternal organization, Price, at the University of Mississippi, who had been put on probation. The fraternity got put on probation, and a friend of mine was the advisor for this particular, the alumni advisor for this fraternity. And he said, we had to go. We got called on the carpet. We had to go before the national fraternity. Go before the conference. We were facing suspension. We were on probation. And he said, everything y'all are telling me we've done. Every bit of it. We own it. But let me tell you what we're going to do from here. You see, as he tried to paint a future, he spoke of the past. As he spoke of the future, he said that to those he was before to say, this is what our present is going to look like. We know the mistakes we've made, and we make a promise that we're going to fix things in the future. Will you allow us to work with you in the present? You see, in a far greater way. I think that's what Jesus was calling his disciples to in our text today. Remember that God has been with you in the past. And remember, friends, that God will sustain you in the future. You see, that's what inspires us to put all of our trust in God when we remember what he's done and what he will do. Then we too can have the faith of the widow in our text today. Reminds me of the faith of Ruth. That was also one of our readings today for our lectionary. Ruth, that great woman of faith and commitment to love and family. You know her story. Some of you do. Ruth, who lost her husband along with her sister-in-law, and they were in this foreign land, and they came back home, and Naomi said to Ruth, you should go back home. You should go back to Moab and find a husband who can take care of you, who can love you, who can nurture you. And Ruth said, no, your home will be my home. I am devoted to you. through Ruth's love and devotion, God had a plan for her that she could have never imagined, Tommy, where she became the very grandmother of King David, the pioneer for many of us who are people of faith. You see, it was Ruth's devotion, her trust in her love of her family that God used to transform the very face of the earth. Friends, I believe that we still have a God of transformation. And when we, in every way we can, will humble ourselves and try in every way we can to help our faith not simply to be about what we can do for God, but never forget what God can do for us. For even as I'm challenging us this day to be more devoted to God, may we never forget what Jennifer read to us this morning in the Hebrews writing. That as much as we're committed to strive in devotion, may we remember how devoted our Savior was to us, is to us, and will always be to us. He went to the highest heavens. He embraced the full measure of sacrifice. We speak of giving until it hurt. Friends, our God gave His very life that we may not only live, but live life more abundantly. He went into heaven and pled the case for you and for me and all who trust in Him. Do you understand the depths of God's commitment to you and sacrifice for you as His children? You know, when I moved into the presidency at Memphis Theological Seminary, I wouldn't say multiple requests for people to write them letters of recommendations, speak on their behalf. And initially, Kathy, I thought, no problem at all. I can always say something nice about someone. And then I had a friend of mine who said, after I'd written a letter of recommendation, they said, you know what? I didn't even have to meet the person. If Jody was for, then I was for. You know what that made me do? It made me pause. You better be careful what you say about someone. Because not only are you speaking for them, but if you mess it up, you're speaking about yourself. You're putting your own credibility on the line, right? When you stand up for someone. Friends, in a far greater way, listen what Jesus Christ did. He went into heaven and stood up for you and said to the Father and King of glory that Robert is worthy to be called your child. Lynn is welcome into the kingdom of heaven. Elizabeth is precious through my blood. I stand up for you. Will you embrace my love and serve this world for my glory, now and forever? Friends, I'm hopelessly devoted to the one who devoted all, that we may have life and abundant joy in Him. Amen. I invite you now to join with me and to pray with me as we lift up together this portion of our worship, the prayers of the people. Let's pray. Oh my God, what a joy it is to join with your people, to lift up in prayer concerns and joys with each other, with those who love us and those that we're called to love. We pray for the ministry of our church. What a blessed gift you are to this congregation. It is your grace, oh God, that sustains us and utilizes us to give your love not only in what we say, but in what we do to the world around us. Will you continue to guide us with your mercy and your providential care as we serve this world as your hands and feet. We pray for each person we've mentioned by name today and those we minister here within this sanctuary and those joining us virtually today. Wherever there is illness, whether it be spiritual, physical, mental, emotional, relational, professional, God, we know you are the physician, one who brings restoration. But we pray not only for our congregation or even our denomination of faith, but wherever your gospel is practiced and proclaimed, will you inspire, oh God, and empower your people in ministry. We pray for our nation. We're grateful to be citizens in this land of liberty and freedom. We give thanks for the veterans who risked their life and even gave their life that we may cherish this great feast of liberty as we remember them this week. We pray, O God, that you guard the hearts and minds of our leaders, those elected by our land to represent us, our president, our Senate, the Congress, the Supreme Court. We pray for our state, our county, and city governing bodies. We ask you to guide any who hold authority in the spirit of Micah, your prophet, to do justice, love mercy, and to walk humbly, O God, in your way. We pray for the least, the last, and the lost. For every person, as we've mentioned on our prayer list, and the names that go unspoken, will you bring healing and wholeness and miracles of grace for friends and family. As we pray for each one of one another and with one another, will you bring your grace to bear in our life? And now, God, as your children, as those claimed by you and set apart to share you with those around us, will you receive our prayer that we lift together as one that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, I ask you to join with me now in remembering and affirming what we believe. Will you stand with me? As children of God, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, friends, as you go forth as the light of Christ, go with this blessing from God above for us below. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance, his gaze upon you, and give you peace now and forever. Amen.